Hello everyone and welcome to Parsi's IAS. Let's take up today's news analysis, that is 12th December 2019. Let's get into our first article of discussion. Our first article is regarding CAB or Citizenship Amendment Bill. So after a heated debate, Rajya Sabha clears Citizenship Bill. Army deployed in Assam, Tripura as violence spreads. So, under this particular topic, we'll try to understand why in news, what is Citizenship Amendment Bill, why there is a lot of opposing chaos in the country against this bill, what is the current status, what will be the after effect after pass, now the bill have been passed both by Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So, what is the after effect and what's the way forward? So first we'll try to understand why in news. This is in news because Rajya Sabha on Wednesday passed Citizenship Amendment Bill or CAB with 125 votes in favour and 99 against. The current strength of upper house is 240. The current CAB or Citizenship Amendment Bill amends Citizenship Act of 1955. So the Citizenship Act which is passed in 1955 will be amended here. Now we'll try to understand what is the Citizenship Amendment Bill talks about or what is the bill stands for. So, Citizenship Amendment Bill or CAB we call it as, which is passed in the year this year, that is 2019, is a bill amending Citizenship Act of 1955. So, this amend Citizenship Act of 1955, and this bill actually what it do is that it makes the illegal migrants who are Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis and Christians from three countries, that is Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh. So this six groups, that is Hindu, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis and Christians from three different countries, that is Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh, who entered India on or before, there is a date given, 31st December 2014, who entered India on or before 31st December 2014, will be eligible for Indian citizenship. So it also seeks to relax the requirement of residence in India for citizenship by naturalization. So we have a clause in constitution which is given very clearly about how can a person get Indian citizenship by naturalization. That means by living in the country for so long. So till now it was 11 years. 11 years a person have to stay continuously in India for getting citizenship in a naturalization process, but CAB will amend this clause by 5 years for this six groups. 5 years is only for this six group. Others they have to leave for 11 years. So immediate beneficiaries of the bill will be, according to IB, is almost like 30,000 people will be benefited by this law. While considering the fact that all this three countries, that is Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh, are Muslim majority countries, therefore Muslims are not included. Sri Lankan Tamils are also not included. And of course there are certain exceptions for this bill. Okay, it is not just applying to whole of India. Exceptions are there. Exceptions says that provisions of bill will not apply to tribal areas of Assam, Tripura, Meghalaya, Mizoram. So tribal areas of these four states will not be applicable, which are included inside the sixth schedule of the constitution, we know that. Okay, and there are areas which are situated in some states like Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, etc., which are called inner line permit. So this is not applicable to these areas also. Bill provides that registration of overseas citizens of India or OCI card holders may be cancelled if they violate any law notified by the central government. Now the current status is that both the houses have passed the bill. Lok Sabha have passed the bill, Rajya Sabha have passed the bill yesterday. So the Union Cabinet have cleared the bill as of now. Now we'll try to understand why is this bill so controversial or why people are opposing this bill. This bill is so controversial because the critics of the bill says that many opposition parties also point out that it discriminates on the basis of religion. So there's discrimination on the basis of religion while passing this bill, because therefore it is against the secular principles of the constitution. Because there is a discrimination on the basis of religion, it is affecting the secularism of Indian constitution. Some constitutional experts have even cautioned that proposed amendments violate Article 14, that is equality to all before law. However, BJP, the current government, have dismissed such concerns. Even the northeastern states are against this bill because, which have long-standing fears of being swamped by migrants and outsiders, are opposed to bill as they believe it will lead to more migrants entering their states. We know that we're considering northeastern part, only scheduled 6 states, that is Assam, Tripura, Mizoram and Meghalaya, and inner line permit areas are only exempted. All other states are obviously included in this bill. So the fact that such migrants may be like Hindus as opposed to Muslims is unlikely to reassure most people from the northeast. Seeing the opposition to the bill in the region where the BJP has made major electoral gains in recent years, next we'll try to understand how is Citizenship Amendment Bill or CAB is linked with NRC or National Registry of Citizens. So Union Home Minister Amit Shah has repeatedly pressed to carry out that NRC process in the entire country will be done by 2024. This was an assurance given by government. So far it's been an Assam specific exercise. Majority of the 2 million people who found themselves excluded from the final list of NRC in Assam were Hindus. So with this bill, if the Hindus are included, then the entire Assam specific exercise of NRC is of no use. This had some curious consequences, including Assam unit of BJP slamming the NRC exercises in the state. So the NRC process or National Registry of Citizens process, which aims to determine who are genuine citizens of India, was carried out in Assam because of the state's peculiar history of migration and protest. And NRC has been a topic of debate in the state for decades. Scaling up the process to all other states will be a massive financial and administrative exercise, but the Modi government is determined to go ahead. Again, to reassure Hindus in states like West Bengal, especially those who from economically and socially poorer backgrounds who lack the required documents to prove their citizenship, BJP seeks to grant them a sort of amnesty from becoming stateless through the CAB or Citizenship Amendment Bill. Why? Because Hindus who are in staying in the country for 5 years, even if they don't have documents, they'll be considered as citizens. So effectively, any person in India who finds himself stateless or liable to be deported will be a Muslim. That means if both the nationwide NRC and citizenship become law. Next, relating to this topic itself, we have another article which says that army deployed in Assam, Tripura as violence spread. So with respect to this article, we can say that army was deployed in Guwahati, Tinsukia and Dibrugarh in Assam and in Kanchananpur and Manu areas in Tripura on Wednesday as protest against the CAB bill continued for the second day also. Another column requisition in Western Assams have been put in standby and paramilitary Assam rifles have been deployed in the Anantbasa area of Kanchanpur, where the situation remains tense following Tuesday's protest. So we can observe that even though the bill is exempted from 6 scheduled areas, that is the states of Assam, Tripura, Meghalaya and Mizoram, then also people in Assam are against, because whatever NRC exercise which have been done, it have made 2 million Hindu population out of their citizenship bill or who are not citizens of India, and with passage of this CAB bill, this 2 million will be as citizens or they will be into the state. Across Assam, railway stations were set afire and curfew is imposed. A railway station in Dibrugarh, hometown of Chief Minister, was set on fire by protesters late in the night. And also the House of Union Minister were attacked by protesters and properties damaged. There was also curfew imposed in Assam. We can see from here. The state government imposed curfew in Guwahati from 6 p.m. till further notice. Mobile internet and data services were suspended for 24 hours in 10 districts of the valley, including Kamrup, that is a metro city, Dibrugarh and Tinsukia. Internet services were already suspended across Tripura for 48 hours from 2 p.m. on Tuesday. When people responded to a shutdown called by North East Students Organization in Assam, hundreds of people poured onto the streets across the state protesting against the CAB. The protest soon went out of control as vehicles and public structures were vandalized or set on fire. Police resorted to baton charges and firing of tear gas. Again, with respect to northeastern states, we have seen a triggered widespread protest in the country where many feel that permanent settlement of illegal immigrants will disturb the region's demography and further burden resources and decrease employment opportunities for indigenous people. A large section of people and organizations opposing the bill also say that it will nullify the provisions of Assam Accord of 1985, which fixed on March 24, 1971 as the cutoff date for deportation and all illegal migrants irrespective of the religion. From this picture, you can understand that how the extent of protest in northeastern states with respect to citizenship amendment bill. Protest in Assam and Tripura is shown here, took a violent turn on Wednesday as thousands of people, including students, hit the streets and fought pitched battles with security forces over the contentious citizenship amendment bill. Now let's get into our second article of discussion today. This is regarding put all courts on high alerts in Jammu and Kashmir, Ladakh, demand judges. Chief Justice warns CRPF security for courts in wake of threats. So, why in news? This is in news because Jammu and Kashmir High Court Chief Justice Geeta Mittal and Judge Rajesh Bindal on Wednesday sought upgradation of security on all courts premises in the Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh, including district courts, in the wake of threats from militants and strike called by the lawyers. The judges also pointed out that Jammu and Kashmir police were unable to control the situation and need to be replaced by Central Reserve Police Force or CRPF. Since the court is having the power of suo motu cognizance, taking suo motu cognizance of the current security apparatus at the courts, including in the twin high court complexes of Srinagar and Jammu, Justice Mittal and Bindal observed that earlier order of the Ministry of Home Affairs dated on May 31, 2007 has not been paid any heed in Jammu and Kashmir. As per these guidelines, the high courts have to be declared high security zones, but this was not followed in Jammu and Kashmir. Censuring the local police, judges suggested that they were experiencing an unusual and very sensitive or a serious situation. It manifests that local police are unable to manage situation and should be replaced by CRPF or Central Reserve Police Force. To our utter chagrin and dismay, the local police are either reluctant to engage with the lawyers or not able to control the situation. Our next article is also related to judiciary, but is related to collegium system. Okay, strength in numbers. A flawed collegium system is no reason to hold back appointments to judiciary. So let's get into this article and see what's been talked about. The article basically talks about alarming numbers and figures relating to depleting numbers in India's higher judiciary as a new addition. That is, on December 10, Supreme Court of India said that 213 names recommended for appointment to various high courts are pending with the government. Data shows that 38% of all sanctioned posts for high court judges are lying vacant as of December 1st, with the high courts of some states including Andhra Pradesh and Rajasthan functioning at below half their actual capacity. So we understood that 213 appointments are still pending, which are decided by the collegium and given to government. So it is pending from the government side to do the appointment. And second one, it talks about the states like Andhra Pradesh and Rajasthan. It works on half the capacity, that is half the capacity functioning at below half their actual capacity. So court had fixed a time period of 6 months to appoint as judges at least those whose names in the Supreme Court collegium, the high courts and government has agreed upon. Basically, at each level of appointment process of judges to the higher judiciary, prior to the names reaching the Prime Minister and the President for final approval, there are time periods specified. The MOP or Memorandum of Procedure, MOP states that appointment should be initiated at least 6 months before. Okay, if a vacancy is there, if obviously there will be notification that vacancy will be there after 6 months. So 6 months before the Memorandum of Procedure or MOP has to happen, and 6 weeks of time is then specified for the state to send recommendations to the Union Law Minister, after which the brief is to be sent to Supreme Court Collegium in 4 weeks. Once the collegium clears the names, Law Ministry has to put up the recommendations to the Prime Minister in 3 weeks, who will in turn advise the President. So the flow of appointment is like that. Collegium will give recommend name towards the Law Ministry, and Law Minister will be given the same list to President. So obviously Prime Minister will be also be overviewing the names. Okay, so thereafter no time limit is prescribed, the process and seemingly comes to a standstill. Once it is sent to president or prime minister, there is no time limit, and it said that almost 213 appointments are pending after reaching prime minister and the president. The Supreme Court's recommendation now of a time limit to these appointments is welcome. It is no secret perhaps that equation between court and union government has been strained by the foremost decision to strike down the unconstitutional in 2015, the movement to set up a National Judicial Appointments Commission, which have been responsible for appointments and transfers to higher judiciary in place of Supreme Court Collegium. Since then, reports of delays in appointments have been increasingly commonplace, with both the sides testy over the procedure. Last week itself, same bench of Supreme Court chastised the government for not acting on another set of nominations on which government has sent back objections. So, if the collegium reiterates the names, court said government has no option but to appoint the judges. Such standoffs are now inevitable. Aggrieved asked for the government to disrupt the process through delays. It is for the court to take an increasing firm hand to ensure that the collegium system that it fought so hard to protect, despite flaws, actually functions effectively. We can summarize this discussion by saying that vacancies in the higher judiciary threaten every aspect of justice delivery system, and it is the courts and every seldom government that always take the blame for any shortfall in justice. Our next article is with respect to science and technology, or very precisely with respect to ISRO. 50th PSLV launch carries radar satellite. RISAT-2BRI will be used for national security. So let's get into this article and see what's been talked about. India's Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, that is PSLV, Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, marked its Golden Jubilee launch on Wednesday by injecting India's Advanced Radar Imaging Satellite, RISAT, or RISAT we say, that is Radar Imaging Satellite, and 9 other customer satellites from states or countries like Japan, Italy, Israel and US into their intended orbits. So, PSLV, which has been history of successful launches of payloads that include Chandrayaan 1, Mars Orbiter mission and the Space Recovery mission, soared into clear blue skies at 3:25 p.m. from the refurbished first launch pad, marking 50th launch of the vehicle. So, today's launch was a historic mission. And there is also an increase in the payload carrying capacity of PSLV. It is the 75th launch from the spaceport with this PSLV 50th launch. And initially PSLV had a carrying capacity of 850 kilogram. And now it is enhanced by this. Over the years, it has been enhanced to 1.9 tons. PSLV is very versatile, having various mission options. ISRO also stated that PSLV has helped take payloads to almost all the orbits in space, including geostationary transfer orbits or GTO, the Moon and Mars, and would soon be launched a mission to the Sun, it is stated by ISRO chief. He also said that in the last 26 years, PSLV has lifted more than 52 tons into space, of which about 17% were of commercial customers. But PSLV has a failure. It has failed only two times. That is a maiden flight to PSLV D1 in September 1993 and C-39 in the August 2017. This one, that is the 50th PSLV mission, will be used for agriculture, forestry, disaster management, support and national security. Now let's get into our next article of discussion. This is regarding heavy metals contaminating India's rivers. Samples from 65% of testing sites were unsafe. Okay, so samples taken from 2/3 of the water quality stations spanning India's major rivers showed contamination of one or more heavy metals exceeding safe limits set by Bureau of Indian Standards or BIS. So these findings are a part of report which is a third edition of an exercise conducted by Central Water Commission CWC from 2014 to 2018. From the samples taken, only 1/3 of the sample water quality are safe and 2/3 is unsafe, obviously. Okay, and because they are polluted by heavy metals, samples from 101 stations have contamination by two metals six stations saw contamination by three metals. Iron emerged as the most common contaminant with 156 of the sampled site registering levels of metal above safe limits. So unsafe two-thirds, the main thing is iron. Okay. And the presence of metals in drinking water is to some extent unavoidable, and certain metals in trace amounts required for good health. However, when present among safe limits, they are associated with a range of disorders. So contamination of metals also are certain limit is okay, but there are also certain disorders reported if there is excess of elements found in drinking water. When we have long-term exposure to the above-mentioned heavy metals may result in slowly progressing physical, muscular and neurological degenerative processes that mimic Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, muscular dystrophy and multiple sclerosis. So these are the diseases which will be formed if the contamination of metals are more or almost towards an unsafe level of having. So 20 river basins were under survey, and other major contaminants that found in samples are lead, nickel, chromium, cadmium, copper. The study spanned 67 rivers in 20 river basins. Lead, cadmium, nickel, chromium and copper contamination are the most common in non-monsoon period, while iron and lead, chromium and copper are there in tolerance limits in monsoon periods. Two important metals, that is arsenic and zinc, are the two toxic metals whose concentration were always obtained within the limits throughout the study period. Certain rivers like Ganga, Yamuna and Godavari are sampled at multiple sites. And while conducting the survey, samples were collected in three different seasons, that is collected during pre-monsoon, during monsoon and post-monsoon. Main sources of heavy metal pollution are mining, milling, plating and surface finishing industries that discharge a variety of toxic metals into the environment. In this graphical representation, we can see very clearly about the amount of metals. It's been talked about chromium, lead and iron. So iron is the major metal that almost exceeds in all the river basins, that is in Ganga, Yamuna, Brahmaputra, Narmada and Godavari, iron exceeds. Okay, when it comes to lead, Ram Ganga, Rapti, lead and chromium exceeds, and otherwise in Ganga we have chromium and iron. So instances when metals exceed the threshold value in some key rivers are there. Threshold value is an average index that captures persistence of pollutants through the year as well as their lethal capacity. That's all for today. Hope this helps. Thank you.